All right. So in this first part of source modeling lectures, I am going to give an introduction to source modeling. This will overlap a little bit with what Robert said already in the morning, but it will also extend it, give a little bit more meat to these concepts in certain aspects. And then I'm going to talk about current dipole models in particular, and in the afternoon when then we will then consider distributed source estimates and beamformers finally. So these are the two parts, introduction and current dipole models. And not by accident, you already saw something like this in the morning. So in the inverse problem, we have the EG and MEG, and we want to arrive at an estimate of the equivalent currents. So this word estimate is actually very important because it includes the notion that our only difficulty is not that the inverse problem is without restrictions ambiguous, but also that we have noisy data. And in the morning we considered the forward solution, which gives for given currents the signals that would have been detected by the EEG and MEG sensors. But what we really want to do in the analysis is do the inverse estimate, that is based on the data arrive at an approximation of the currents in the brain. And this forward solution is in principle straightforward because that was solved in the 19th century by Maxwell's equations. So it's just like an application problem. There's no physical uncertainty in this. And some people say that the model in MEG is that the signals are linearly related to the current amplitudes. That's not a model, that's the truth. That's the fact, physical fact, which we cannot escape. It's not the model in the sense of a statistical model. And this is very important to understand because understanding this physics of the situation helps to also to understand what we can obtain in the inverse solution. So in the inverse problem, our situation is a little bit like this, that we have a dinosaur who was dead a long time ago, and then the paleontologists come and dig up the bones. And then they, based on this insufficient data, they try to arrive on an estimate of the appearance of the dinosaur. And they do a pretty good job, but some mistakes were made. Some parts were misconnected. And this is very close to the situation in the inverse problem of MEG and EEG also. We get the overall picture right, but some of the details are not absolutely correct, and we need to know what is going to be the useful correct information that we obtain. So from the electric, we have the electric currents of the brain in step two. We cannot directly access this activity, but we measure the EEG and MEG, pick up the bones, and then try to estimate what the currents that produce the data were. Importantly, we are not on the mercy of a single experiment like in this dinosaur case. We can modify the experiment and try to triangulate the problem from different angles and thereby get a better picture of the situation. The fundamental reason why we cannot uniquely reconstruct a dinosaur is that there are currents in the brain that produce no MEG, no EEG, or no MEG nor EEG. An example of a current which doesn't produce an MEG is a radial dipole in a sphere. We can add radial dipoles at will to the solution, and the explanation of the data is equally good, so therefore we cannot obtain information about the radial currents. Now, if we would have current loops in the brain, then there wouldn't be any EEG on the surface. But this configuration is unlikely. We don't expect to have these loop currents in the brain. So this is out. But this is a practical situation that if you have a closed surface and currents uniformly on the surface, then there's no MEG nor EEG outside the brain. And this is often called the closed closed current configuration or closed field configuration. And that this may occur if, for example, a structure which is very close to spherical is completely activated. And one way to state the inverse problem is also to say that there are many ways to make the problem unique. It's not that we cannot arrive at the unique solution, but the way we arrive to the unique solution is not unique. So this is very important to understand also. There are many discussions between people whether one solution is better or the other. All solutions are best. It's just that all definitions of best are not equally good. For example, if you assume that there are magnetic dipoles in the brain, your solution is going to be totally incorrect because the correct model for the sources is a current dipole. And if you model the field of a current dipole with a magnetic dipole, you get a magnetic dipole which is located several centimeters deeper in the white matter. So this is certainly not a good definition of best, to find the best fitting magnetic dipole. So this is important to understand, that discussion is really what is the most reasonable assumption. And two kind of classical approaches to the inverse problem are to use either parametric models or current distribution models. Parametric models mean that you assume that the current distribution has sufficiently few free parameters so that they can be uniquely fitted to the data by least squares fit. That is, we have more measurements than source parameters. And in practice, this means that we assume that there's a limited number of current dipoles in the brain. I will talk about this more later. Then next, in the afternoon, we will consider current distribution models, which assume that there are many sources in a volume or on the cortical surface. And in this case, we have many more sources than measurements, and therefore we need an additional constraint which renders the problem unique. We cannot anymore just fit the data with the model data by a least squares fit to arrive at a solution. There are many possibilities because of the huge number of sources. And the typical additional constraint is that we require that in addition to the fitting the data, the norm of the current distribution is minimized. And now there are multiple different norms. There is the L2 norm, which is the square sum of the amplitudes of the currents. And this L2 norm solution is commonly called the minimum norm estimate. In other words, the overall power of the current is minimized. And the benefit of this is that it leads to a linear solution, which is easy to compute. But the problem with MNE is that the solution is quite widespread. We have good reasons to assume that often the activity in the brain is sparse. It's only a few locations in the brain active, like in the dipole models, and they also that these sources have a limited extent. And then we can use L1 or mixed norm approaches which make use of this assumption. And finally, there are beamformers which take a little bit different approach to the inverse problem. They don't strictly fit the data, but rather require that we try to, as closely as possible, estimate the time course at a certain location in the brain while eliminating interference from the other locations. But it turns out actually that the beamformer and minimum norm solutions are not so far from each other, theoretically speaking, as one could imagine, in practical situations where there is also noise and not enough data to estimate the covariance matrix needed in the beamformers. This is, I think, a very good thing to keep in mind. This illustrates the ambiguity of the inverse problem in another way. Don't take this as a pessimistic picture, but as a picture which is useful to understand so that you don't make false statements about your data. So let's assume that the actual source in the brain is a focal source which can be really well approximated by a current dipole. it produces this familiar field pattern, like this dipolar field pattern, maxima on both sides of the current. Now if we fit the current dipole to these data, if there's low noise, we get the current dipole exactly back, because this reproduces the data produced by the original source. Another possibility is to use a minimum norm solution which is spread out in space. It also has the property that it explains the data. And now, therefore, by actually having this minimum norm estimate as the source, we get exactly the same field pattern, and of course we get the same minimum norm estimate solution, and we get the same dipole as before. So starting from these two quite different actual sources, we get exactly the same predictions of the sources in the brain using these two different methods. What this means in practice is mainly that the extent of the source is difficult to estimate, because these two types of distributions, one of which is focal and the other distributed, can equally well reproduce the data. This is in general true. Extent is difficult to estimate. Now, as should have become clear by now, these inverse modeling approaches have many common features. They select an elementary source model, and almost all approaches, including preinformers, use the current dipole as the elementary source. This has been now clarified for the preinformers nicely, that it's really the same elementary source model. But earlier on, there were strange statements like saying that beamformers don't use current dipoles. Don't believe this. They exactly use current dipoles. So they, as the elementary source, they are in that sense the same as other source models. And I already mentioned that the current dipole model can be expressed so that the target is to minimize the least squares difference between the measured data and the data produced by the sources. Therefore, this is an optimization problem. And also the distributed source estimate approaches can be expressed as an optimization problem where you minimize the sum of the mismatch between the predicted and measured data, and combined with the term depending on the source parameters. And this is very useful to understand. So you first specify the elementary source model, then you specify what you assume about the sources, then you set up this optimization problem, and then you set up a way to solve the optimization problem. Sometimes these boundaries are kind of made unclear. That's not very nice, because the solution of the optimization problem is just a technical point. In principle and in practice, you can have many ways to solve the same problem. Some of them are better and some of them are worse, but they should produce the same answer, because they solve the same problem. Now, finally, all source models assume that noise is Gaussian and often now correlated across the sensors, which means that there's a noise covariance matrix describing the noise in the sensor space. And everything becomes much clearer conceptually if you think about this, so that you widen the data using the inverse of the noise covariance matrix, so that you avoid directions in the sensor space where there is a lot of noise that is way these directions less. As a special case of this assumption, you can assume that the noise covariance is diagonal, meaning that there are no correlations across sensors. But a better assumption is really to estimate the whole noise covariance matrix as best as you can. And finally, of course, all source estimation approaches need the forward model. Now, there are kind of moving boundaries also between these terms. I would say that source model really means that you determine the elementary source. Inverse model means that you define the optimality criteria. You define what is best for you. And in this you use the anatomical and physiological information. Focal source is one which is of small extent. It can be often approximated by a current dipole. An extended source is source large enough to be distinguishable from a current dipole from a distance. But this is not easy to do because often this extended source can be very well still accounted for by a current dipole. A little bit more about that later. Now, distributed sources are those where many focal or extended sources are in the different parts of the brain. So extended means just extended locally. And finally, the forward model is the method for computation of the MEG, like the sphere model shown here. So the simplest source model is to assume that there's a single current dipole in the brain. And this works surprisingly well for early parts of basic sensory responses, for example, early somatosensory, early visual responses, and also early auditory responses in the sense that the sources are far apart from each other on the two hemispheres so that they can be almost handled separately. The patterns measured from them don't overlap in space like Robert pointed out. When you go further away from the source, you get less contribution from that source. In other words, if you are here versus here, you either get the right hemisphere auditory source contribution or the left hemisphere auditory source contribution. And how this equivalent current dipole fit works is that you minimize the difference between the measurement and the model. Here I have omitted the fact that we nowadays also take into account the noise covariance and weigh this difference according to the noise. So in this approach, we select an initial guess for the dipole location, and then we calculate the smallest least squares error between the measurement and the model that can be achieved by adjusting the dipole orientation and amplitude at this initial location. Then if the error is the same as in the previous step, at first there's no previous step, we stop. Otherwise, we find a better candidate for the dipole location and go back to step two, so that we again adjust the amplitude because it's a linear fit which can be done easily. So we iterate this so that we start at some location, we move the dipole until we get the best fit. And fortunately for one dipole, this is a very robust fit in general and can be reasonably easily done and is very reliable. For the multi-dipole case, we need to be a little bit more careful, and it's not as straightforward an extension of this as one could think. And the first iterative MEG dipole fits were done 30 years ago by Timo Tuomisto and others in Helsinki for auditory data. So there's a long history for this approach. So let's look a little bit more at the single dipoles. So I will show you some simulations in which I have activated a patch of cortex, not the single point. I have calculated the corresponding MEG and EG and fitted the dipole. Extended sources. So here is a patch of cortex in the auditory areas. Then I fit the dipole to it. It's the closest point on the surface happens to be in the parietal lobe, but that's not really significant because this is just on the opposite side of the sulcus. But anyhow, it's very, very close. And the goodness of fit for this extended source is 99.9%. So in the noiseless case, so you cannot really easily separate this extended distribution from a current dipole. And indeed, if you look at situation in the anatomical MRI where the red indicates the activated area on the cortex and the green dot the fitted current dipole is right at the correct location. So this is the kind of an accuracy that you get. So that a couple of 1 to 2 centimeters extent is still like a dipole, yes? So how about then the radial sources? When I produce these slides, I try to extend the source and move it around to make a situation where MECC is nothing and ECC is something. And I failed, basically. So this is the best I could do. This is a little patch on the gyrus in the supratemporal gyrus so that the current should be radial, but if you take the actual shape of the cortex into account, it's very difficult to produce a radial source. This is the best I could do. So this is the MEG pattern and this is the EEG pattern produced by this source which was pointing towards you actually. You see this maximum in the EEG indicating the radial source, but still there's some tangential component of the source which is seen in MEG. And indeed the EEG, if it is more correct, is right at on the spot, whereas MEG tries to fit the tangential dipole to it and is a little bit incorrect. So this existence of radial sources can shift sources a little bit. But remember now that this is a noiseless simulation, so this difference probably goes away in practical noise considerations. So there's Robert already mentioned that the dipoles are offset by the existence of an extended source, and this is what happens if, let's say that there's a sulcal wall like this and the source is extended sideways. This means that the extrema of the field pattern are a little bit further away than they would be if the source is focal, because there's current going sideways like this, so that it pushes the extrema away, so that in this case the depth is going to be overestimated. On the other hand, if the extension is in the radial direction, then these parts of the current are better seen than these parts, and therefore the equivalent current dipole is not exactly at the midpoint of this strip, but closer to the more superficial part. So it's not always straightforward to say where exactly this best fitting dipole is, because the center of mass is not only the center of mass of the dipole locations, but is affected by the gain from different locations to the sensors. The gain is lower when you go deeper. And I should also mention that this equivalent current dipole is usually used as a term for the result of the fitting. It's the best fitting dipole. And this term actually tells you that the very important thing, when we use the dipole model, we don't think that there are dipoles in the brain. We think that we cannot do a distinction between a dipole and the actual source based on the measurements. And if you use dipole models and somebody ridicules you saying that you are assuming that there are dipoles in the brain, don't be fooled. Just tell bravely that I am not assuming that. Now, an extension of the single dipole model is the multi-dipole model, and usually it's used in the form of this time-varying multiple dipole model, which was advocated by Michael Scherk starting from early 80s. And in this model, we assume first of all that the sources are sufficiently small extent so that we can use the dipole as a surrogate of each of these activated patches indicated here by the orange lines. And then we assume that the dipole locations are fixed with time, meaning that these activated areas stay the same. And then we allow the dipole amplitudes to vary to account for the data. And I should mention that Mikael used this very successfully with remarkably simple EC data. EC data collected from a line passing basically over the two auditory cortices and through the vertex. And he was able to make good predictions of the relative amplitudes and time courses of the sources in the two auditory cortices from this simple data. Of course, he couldn't tell the front to back location of the sources, but he could still make good amplitude estimates. And that led ultimately to the present methods, and also this method is widely used in his software package PISA and also in the Neuromax software, which I will demonstrate later. Now, so let's look at the technical part a little bit more. So the model of the measurement is really that we have this forward model fact, the gain from current dipoles to the measurements, and then we have noise in the data. So that this gain matrix here, the solution of the forward problem, has p columns where p equals the number of dipoles we use, and then the rows of this q matrix are the time courses of the dipoles, meaning that these data produced by unit dipoles at known locations and orientations are then multiplying the source waveforms to produce the data after the noise is added, meaning that we assume that the data are produced by these changing waveforms times constant field patterns. And again, to arrive at this solution, we use the same approach, basically, technically speaking, as in the single dipole fit. We have the locations and orientations of the currents and try to fit the data. We select the number of dipoles, we select the initial guesses for dipole locations, we calculate the smallest least squares error between the measurement and the model, assuming that locations are fixed and then allowing the orientations and amplitudes to change. And then if the error is the same as in the previous iteration step, stop, otherwise find better candidates for the dipole locations, go back to step 3 and loop until you get out. Seems simple enough. But now the challenge is that first of all you need to know how many dipoles. Second, you need to select initial guesses. This third step is trivial, and fourth step is trivial. And then you have to have a rule for finding better candidates, and go to back to step 3 is, of course, trivial. So the main challenge in the multiple dipole fitting is that this nonlinear optimization procedure described by steps 2 to 5 is not easy to implement so that you get to the right answer. And furthermore, it may be due to the nonlinear nature of the problem that there's one solution which gives the smallest least squares error. But then there might be another solution which is far from it in terms of the constellation of the dipoles, which is almost as good. But that is actually the solution which you want. And this kind of conflict is very difficult to automatically resolve. You can be objective, but you can often clearly see that the solution is wrong. For example, if you fit auditory data in EEG and you don't have sufficiently many electrodes here in the lower parts of the head to cover the other extremum of the potential pattern, the two auditory dipoles in the two hemispheres try to collapse in the middle. So this is totally wrong. Or they try to collapse to something which is frontal. So it's maybe not slight error that you make, but a big error. You do the fact that there's a nonlinear relationship between the position and of the dipoles and the amplitudes measured by the sensors. And therefore, there are all kinds of ways to work around this fact. some people really despise almost this heuristic approach, but it's not so bad, because you actually, in this approach, in fact, incorporate other information that you might have from the brain and from of the signals. And some of the tricks that can be used, which I will demonstrate hopefully, are to select, first of all, time points where only one dipole is active, so that you can fit dipoles separately and then finally arrive at the model. And then you can use selections of channels so that you, for example, in the ordinary case, you can fit the right and left hemispheres separately at first and then get a good initial guess and then let the fitting loose and get the correct solution. And in general, it's often advisable to construct the model dipole by dipole, so that at each addition of dipole, typically a lot of the previous explanation remains unchanged and something new is explained by the addition of the dipoles. And in this procedure, it's really helpful that the planar gradiometers, which I showed on Monday, measure mostly activity underneath them. So in other words, you get this peak above the source. And therefore, you can get an idea where the sources are from the data itself, from the somatosensory data, which we saw on Monday. And for this type of data, a possible strategy for fitting the data is that you fit this one dipole in the primary somatosensory cortex contralateral to the stimulus at an early latency when it's active alone. Then you fit the two S2 responses using channel selections which are lateral, because the S2s are near the auditory cortex but in the parietal lobe. And finally you let the S2 fitting loose, but keep the S1 dipole fixed. You don't allow it to move anymore because you have a reliable location for the S1 dipole. And this often results in a good solution. At the end, you obtain the locations of the dipoles. In this case, there was also a motor task, so that there's a motor cortex dipole in the hemisphere opposite to the primary somatosensory cortex dipole. And then you get the time courses of the dipoles, which you can evaluate in many ways. Now, it's important to realize that this linear fitting can be done irrespective of the signal-to-noise ratio of the data, meaning that if you have determined the locations of the dipoles, you can fit individual responses, like in this case from the somatosensory data. You see here in blue the time course of the dipoles fitted to the average data for S1, for the two S2 cortices, and for the motor cortex in the opposite hemisphere. And now what I did was to assume that the dipoles are the same for each of these four epochs and then fitted the amplitudes of the dipoles using these fixed dipole locations and orientations. And I got the result in which these, especially these early S1 deflections, are very faithfully reproduced in each of these epochs. But in the S2s, there's much more variation, which is conceivable because of the different role of the S2 cortices in processing, and motor responses are quite different across the trials, because the motor response, first of all, doesn't occur at the same time with respect to the stimulus, because it's determined by the subject.
Yep. When you say that the dipoles are equal, in what sense?
Location is equal and orientation is equal, so that the same areas in the brain are activated in each of these epochs. It's kind of the assumption also behind averaging, of course, that if you make an evoked response study, you assume that each response is the same. And these variations are then caused by noise, and caused by the fact that responses are not the same. They are they at least vary, are allowed to vary in amplitude. And it indeed seems that there are these variations, true variations in the amplitudes of the responses.
So when you set the strategy, then at one point you would optimize S2 dipoles at the same time. But you would do that only on the time course, on the later time course, right?
Yes.
You would not include the early time.
It doesn't really matter as long as you keep the S1 dipole fixed.
Yeah.
Can I just follow up? And that first location, is that in the auditory case? Is it at the onset of taken from the onset of a stimulus, or?
So the first location in the auditory case, you typically use the N100 for the location. So finally, I would like to list caveats, which I already alluded to. One caveat is that it's difficult to find the optimal dipole locations automatically. And there are all kinds of approaches in addition to the heuristics. There are genetic algorithms, multistar simplex algorithm, music algorithms, which try to circumvent this problem. But I think it would be fair to say that none of these gained popularity. People don't trust that these produce the right solutions. My colleague Riitta Salmelin once put this very nicely in an educational session. I gave a talk about the source modeling, and she gave a talk about some language-related data which had complex dipole configurations and explained these heuristics. And then there was a question from the audience, why don't you let Matti's program to fit the dipoles automatically? And she answered, because it gives the wrong result. And this is the second point really, which I already mentioned, that it wasn't the result which was in accordance to all the other information she had about the sources. And then it's unlikely that the dipole model would fail because the sources are too extended to be represented by a dipole. So now questions about the dipole approach.